and welcome to the Reading Film Fest. Tonight's program is based on the movie Hustle. We're going to have a panel discussion with folks that were in the movie that are from our local area, and one surprise guest here that's from outside the area, but it's an Alvernia grad. I'll introduce to my media right, Mr. Chaz Franklin. He hails from Philadelphia. He was in the movie. He has worked with the TBT organization. Some of you guys see that over summer. He also has coached and played overseas for 15 years. And he attended Hampton University and is working in Philadelphia and was so gracious to join us this evening. And you're gonna hear more from him, but I wanna introduce the rest of the panelists. And then this guy in the middle, some of you might recognize him. His name is Juju Jordan, and I call him Juju Double Step Back Jordan from his role in the movie. Juju graduated from Wyomissing. He is a fixture in every playground in this city. He's everywhere if you're playing. And I think he has a very interesting story to tell you about the movie also. And then the last gentleman at the table here, Mr. Brian Nerney, is a Alvernia graduate. What year?
2012.
2012, Alvernia graduate. He was also in the movie, but what is, I think, even more interesting, he is an account executive or
account manager
for Paramount Pictures, okay? And we were talking in the green room, he's selling ads for TV shows, okay? How many of you think that you could sell ads for TV shows? Everybody in this room should have their hand up, okay? Brian will tell you how to do it.
Yeah. All right. But easy.
Easy. Well, what we're going to do tonight, by a show of hands, how many people saw the movie Hustle? And be honest if you didn't. Okay. Just so you know, that movie from June 8th to June 19th on Netflix was the most watched movie in the country, okay? And that's going to be important. Actually, we're going to come back to that at the end of this program because it's going to be symbolic, something we need to work on. But because it was the most watched movie in the country, these folks who were basically doing things by day became movie actors. And as each one of them told me in the back, after this movie hit, their phones blew up. People were calling them, you know, getting in touch with them. But what I would like you to share, each one of you, how you found out the movie, how you got involved, and why don't we just start there? How you found out, how you got involved?
Well, the way I started, you know, I'm from the Philadelphia area. I've done a lot of things in the region, basketball-wise. I've done some work in the G League for the Sixers organization, so I'm kind of entrenched in that culture. So the word kind of got out that Adam Sandler was doing a movie. I have a good friend of mine named Pete Postiglione. He's from Springfield, Pennsylvania, and he's a professional actor. So he kind of forced it on me. Hey, man, you know, you're around. You have to be in it. You know, he kind of sold it as like a cameo situation for me. I didn't think that I was at the level where it would be considered a cameo, but that's how I found about it. I kind of got flooded from different people in the Philadelphia basketball region, just talking about the upcoming movie.
Yeah, I found out through social media, and the ad listed basketball players over 18 with experience, and I just fit the category, and I went out and did my thing.
Yeah, I was kind of the same way. I feel like after the 50th DM, I'm a big Adam Sandler fan. I was telling these guys I have a Big Daddy movie poster in my basement. I've had it for since the movie came out 1999. And after like the 50th DM, my mom actually called me and said, you know, my friend just called me and said Adam Sandler's looking for basketball extras in some movie. So I looked into it and I went down to the Sixers practice facility in Wilmington. And yeah, waited in line for like 2 or 3 hours. I played 3-on-3 for 2 minutes and took my picture afterwards, and someone called me 2 or 3 months later and said, you're in the Philly area now. Can you be here on this day? So very fortunate, very lucky to you know, be picked out of, you know, who knows how many people did the same thing.
How many people you think were there?
I mean, it was from like 8 a.m. to, I think, 5 or 6 at night. My guess would be, I mean, I, I'll I'll say thousands, so it sounds better for me. But, yeah, maybe. There was definitely – we were there for a long time. So, me and Buddy came with me. Unfortunately, he didn't get a call. But, yeah, it was a cool experience.
Okay. And the thing that or I would say the reason or the genesis for coming up with this program is the Reading Film Festival, one of their major goals is to get a feature film made here in Reading, Pennsylvania. Myself and the executive director, we talked about, there was a movie that was made here years ago called Rabbit Run. Probably me and Coach are the only ones that remember that because that's how old it is. But that movie sort of put Reading on the map, and the Film Fest, which is running this weekend, they got films showing every day up until Sunday. And by the way, all of you students have free passes to go. So they have movies at the IMAX, they have movies at the Goggle Works, and there's booklets over there that'll tell you what movies are running, but you have free passes to go. So that's on behalf of the film festival for just showing up today. But the film fest, one of their goals is to get a feature film made in Reading. So the reason why you guys took headshots when you came in here is if we ever get the opportunity, okay, they're going to have headshots and people to contact, possibly to be in the movie when the filmmaker starts to look for people, extras or things like that. So that's why I wanted headshots of everybody. I saw all his pictures in the thing, yeah.
Did that help?
You know what's funny? When I got there, there was only three of us who were waiting for another three, so I made sure I dunked it a few times while we were warming up. And then when we got into 3-on-3, they asked, hey, look, we're mainly looking for a certain look and just the movements. You know, you didn't have to score a ton of points. And it was funny, I was actually guarding my buddy a couple of times, and I was just like whispering to him, like, shoot it. Like, you know, let's get good looks here. And yeah, we played for a few minutes, and next thing you know, we took like a headshot, just kind of like you said, for these guys today. And then, yeah, someone called me a couple minutes later. But yeah, I made sure to throw a couple down while we were warming up.
How about you, Juju? How did you come up with your spot? Did you guys see what he did in the movie? Okay,
oh, yeah.
That double step back, and then he threw the ball and walked away when he was playing Bo Cruz for $50. Okay, and what the bet was, if the ball would even touch the rim, you got the $50.
Yeah, and then if he scored, he got 100.
Yeah.
The way I came up with my scene, well, I actually didn't come up with it. It actually was like pictured off B.A. I don't know if you guys know who that is. He did the Harden step back, and they made fun of him for it. They actually wanted me to rehearse that a couple times. And that wasn't like the first go-to thing. They had me showcase my dribbling, my shooting, everything. But the main goal of like my scene was to make people laugh and get people to get into the movie, wake up a little bit. And
so the director told you that?
Yeah. He told me that I had to do the double step back.
Okay. Coach?
For me, I played the role of a Sixer scout on the balcony. As far as preparation for it, it was easy for me. I just had to stand there and watch the game and argue with the guy next to me. So it's kind of like my natural way that I live my life anyway. So it was great just kind of just arguing about basketball. So, you know, that was my role, and that's kind of how I prepared for it, just kind of being myself.
Wow. So and you were actually arguing with it, or you guys just made something up, or –
No, well, we actually argued. We had a lot of time to kind of figure it out. I'm pretty sure he cursed at me at one point. I kind of cursed back. They cut that part out. So it was kind of a freestyle thing, although I had to say, like, oh, he shoots 42% from three. And that was the extent of my line that they asked.
Okay. And in terms of the movie, did you have any idea that it was going to be as big as it was, or – like, did you get any sense when you were filming that it was going to be a big deal?
Absolutely. First things first, my agent, he, you know, like from when I was a player and coaching, he told me that, like, what it was going to be.
Oh,
like,
wow.
It was LeBron James had a hand in it. Yeah. So this was working behind the scenes for some time now. And then obviously when you're on set, and I'm sure you got, you know, you guys can agree, it's a who's who of who's in the NBA. Yeah.
Who did you meet? Did you?
I met everybody. Uh-huh. You know, I guess my Instagram is like full of it. Kyle Lowry was there in my scene. I already had a pre-existing relationship with him, just being from Philadelphia. I met Kenny the Jet Smith from ESPN. The first part of my scene, I kind of worked as a stand-in, which means that when Adam Sandler gets tired, you're going to stand there and, like, pretend to be him while he's kind of eating grapes in the back. So I did that. So, you know, I stood next to him. That was for, what, 6 hours? Just standing there talking basketball and football and that kind of thing. Anthony Edwards. I met Steve Urkel from back in the day. He was in my scene. Jaleel White, right? Jaleel White. Who else? I met Trey Young. Mike James was in my scene. I actually almost got probably kicked off the scene because you weren't supposed to go into the green room. So when the security guard kind of dipped off, I just kind of snuck back there and, you know, kind of went live, and it was great. So, yeah, that's what I did.
Okay. Juju?
Yeah, a lot of names. I met The Professor, Bone Collector, Trey Young, Tobias Harris, A.O., Alimo. I knew it was going to be big from the start because it's just so many people, so many names, so many. And a lot of people came on my scene. I was in the Philly scene next to Geno's. A lot of people came to my scene because who doesn't like Geno's? Like, everybody just came, grab a cheesesteak after our scene. We got done around probably like 1 a.m. Geno's still open. We all just went over and chilled.
That's awesome. I guess for my scene, I only did one day, and I was at the Palestra, so the only two guys I met besides Sandler, which I snuck a picture, that's a story with him, that's a story in itself. I met Mo, the guy they end up drafting in the movie, and Barbosa was on the other team, but he was only there for maybe 15 minutes. He did two takes, and then they had a stand-in for him for the whole day, but I did sneak, like I said, huge Adam Sandler guy, and we broke for lunch. I guess a couple of the producers, they kind of had a beef going, and they were going to play one-on-one, and they had a ref.
They had a referee.
They had a ref to, you know, ref this one-on-one game, and they definitely did not like each other. And Adam was staying behind, and me and one of the other kids that I became buddies with was like, hey, maybe if we stay behind, this is where we can, like, you know, get a picture with him. We talked to him a few times before he was there, and I think he stayed around longer because, like, we weren't, like, fanboying over him. Like, he just was, like, he just wanted to talk hoops, and, you know, he ended up staying, like, a lot longer. And then later on in the day, everybody left for lunch. It was, like, 4 or 5 of us in the gym, and we were kind of walking off the court at the same time, and I had my phone on my hip ready to go. And he said, he's like, do you guys want to take a picture? And I was like, yeah, if you don't mind. I don't want to be a bother. I'm just happy to be here. And he couldn't have been nicer to me in that, you know, couple minutes. We talked for a little bit. And, he took pictures with everybody. And, you know, he was just a normal guy that just liked talking hoops. So I thought that was, like, the coolest part, just getting to talk to him. And we were rebounding for him and, you know, putting up shots. He passed me the ball one time. And I looked at him, I said, you know, I got to put this up. And thank God I made it. So, just awesome experience. I mean, I would have done it for the picture alone. Man. But, got to meet a lot of – I think I met more locally, like, you know, those former college Temple guys, Lafayette, Lehigh, whether it was Widener, just – there was just, you know, basketball junkies that were just, you know, excited to be there for the day. So it was a cool experience.
How do you think your – basketball experience, high school or college with their teams, or how did that prepare you for this? You know, going out there and playing. What are some of the things you remember? I know we all had those things. Coaches, some of their mantras that stick in your mind. Did any of that stuff pop into your mind while you're out there on the court?
So I guess a fun fact about me: I used to play for the Washington Generals, which that's the team who plays and travels against the Globetrotters. So that was like my 15 seconds of fame after school, and so I guess you could say I've been in show business before. For me, I was just kind of like an extra in the background. We were on the bench just cheering on, and you know, I just try to, you know, soak up every moment I could take, but I didn't take it for granted. And no, it's a big testament to, you know, Alvernia. I'm not from here. I'm from the Jersey Shore. So I didn't, when I was going on the, like, the recruiting trail, I actually didn't get recruited by Alvernia. My guidance counselor and mother found it on, like, a search, and it was on the way home from another school we were looking at. I think it was DeSales, and I took one tour around, and I said, this is where I want to be. Everything else.
So you like Reading?
I love Reading. I just moved to Conshohocken, so I'm a little closer.
you just shocked these kids.
Because yeah, no, I'm a kid from the beach that ended up in Reading. So, I mean, yeah, it was weird. I took one lap around the campus, and I loved it. And obviously basketball was important to me. I was fortunate enough to play basketball and track at Alvernia, but I just kind of took a walk around. I said, this is where I want to be. Everything else will work itself out. And then that's when I introduced myself to Coach Miller and a couple guys on the staff and said, hey, I'm kind of getting looked at from this school and this school. We're kind of in the same level. What do you think? So I kind of just walked on. And yeah, my freshman year, I played 3 games, 5 minutes. And then my next year, I was averaging 38 minutes a game, and I never looked back. So it's a grind. It's not easy. Everybody's path, like these guys, is completely different. And, you know, you got to keep your grades up, and like Coach Miller said, and you know, you got to put in the work because, you know,
but
it's
you,
not
you
easy.
Bet on yourself.
You bet on yourself. Ended up doing 2 sports, which my body regrets now. Yeah, and then after the fact, like, you know, with the Generals, and, you know, I bounced around a couple other places, and because of the game of basketball is the reason why I'm at the company I'm at, which I see an MTV shirt over there. That's one of the channels that we own right there, yeah. And, yeah, so that's the reason I was playing for a guy in a summer league that was sponsoring the team. We had MTV on our shirt, so I didn't put the correlation together. Started talking to him, and I saw the path and the lifestyle he was living, and, you know, I started asking questions, and then 3-4 years later, I said, all right, I think I'm hanging the sneakers up, and I've been at Paramount 7 years now, so I wouldn't trade it for the world.
Cool. Juju?
For me, it was really just, like, bringing good body language and looking presentable and standing out more than everybody else. So the one thing that I didn't really bring anything with me, just basketball mindset and don't look back. When I got there, I was graded on really just how confident I was and how well I, like, moved on the basketball court. So just be confident in yourself and, like you said, betting yourself 100%.
I think the game of basketball prepared me in the sense of teaching you how to network with different people, you know, like you alluded to or actually, you know, stated earlier. I know you guys are young, and you guys play basketball. I'm assuming you guys are ball players.
Yeah, they're all on different teams.
All on different teams here. Yeah. The thing that I found out, you know, as I'm at this stage of my career, like being retired, the thing that I cherish the most is the relationships that you build with people. They seem to last the longest. The friendships that you have, the people that I still hate from the 90s because we lost, the people that you argue with and fought with, your college teammates, like, you know, we've never met before, but we're connected, you know, through a mutual friend. His college roommate was my assistant coach for some big tournament on ESPN. So there's a connectedness. I played a number of different countries over the years, 11 different countries. Some of my teammates, we couldn't speak a common language. I don't speak Arabic, I don't speak French, right? But we were connected through basketball. So I think that it all comes full circle. I mean, I never had any intention of being, you know, in any sort of movie that wasn't. I was an athlete, you know, to let alone be, I guess, as you stated, the number one movie on Netflix. But through your relationships that you build, just, you know, as we say, like through hooping, that's kind of our thing. You know, you really, some coach once said, you don't know a man until you hooped with him, right? It all comes out. Your character, sometimes your lack thereof, your competitiveness. So it kind of helped me out in that way and also gave me an appreciation for those who did work in the arts and those who were, you know, in the acting industry. I saw how hard they worked as well. I mean, I was on set sometimes 15 hours a day, and Adam Sandler didn't sit down not once. And I thought about that. I said, damn, I sit down all the time. Right? Maybe I need to stand up more. I'd be more successful, right? So that's how it prepared me.
Made me think of Coach Carrill. You guys know who Pete Carrill is? Okay, Pete Carrill had a saying that basketball reveals your character. Let me watch you run two or three drills, and I can tell you exactly what you're about. Do you jump in the back of the line when there's a drill? Are you the first one in line? Are you going hard? Are you going half speed? He could tell all that stuff. And the one thing I'll never forget, he said he never recruited kids that the family had two garages. He said he wanted two garage guys. He said one garage or no garage. Okay, and you guys, you know what that means? He didn't want two garage guys. Okay. He wanted kids from working class families because they knew what it was to work, and he didn't want kids that were soft. Okay, and that's what I think of kids from Reading. You're working class kids. You're not soft. Okay, Reading. That means Lauderdale, Berks County. It's all working class kids. You're not soft. So. The other thing that I thought was great about the movie came out of LeBron's company and his production company. Did they tell you that there was any connection to him, or did they talk to you about that?
Well, they didn't tell me initially. However, you know, I just kind of heard it, like I said, through the agent. He's like, oh, LeBron's coming out with this thing, and obviously anything that his name is attached to, you know, gain some steam. But I didn't hear it officially. I mean, the reality is, you know, when you're getting selected for these roles, I mean, I don't know, like, how your process was. Mine was, like, the night before. I thought it was spam. I didn't even think that it was real. You know what I mean? So, you know, I had no idea as far as from the mainstream situation, but, you know, I kind of had some intel from it, from an inside source, I guess you can say.
Yes. I didn't hear LeBron was a part of it. Same thing. I just woke up. My mom was screaming, and yeah, they need you out in Philly.
Okay.
Yeah, I think I was the same way. I just saw like it was like literally an ad on Instagram, like, and then I think I was one of the last days to film. So before I got it, you start seeing stuff on Facebook and Instagram that the articles in Philly are coming around where they're filming and who's associated with and who's been on, you know, some of these guys' sets. So I kind of had an idea going in then, but not after I, you know, left the, I guess, the audition, you could say.
Okay, and this question goes back to sort of what Juju alluded to when he's talking about Geno Stake and, you know, some of the iconic areas. I'm sure you students don't know this, but when they were beginning to look at locations to shoot the movie, they actually went to Reading High School, and they had looked in the Geigel. And Mr. McLeod told me they had just redone the gym. And he said he was like, they were like, well, this doesn't look like a high school gym. This is like a college gym. And it's interesting, they ended up using Coatesville. I don't know if you guys realized that was Coatesville High School gym that they were using in the movie. And it was interesting. We were like, you know, was it that Coatesville was closer to Philly and, you know, Reading was a little bit further. But the fact that they actually considered the Geigel, and we know it's, you know, one of the best places to watch basketball on the East Coast. I won't say necessarily our old country, but a lot of people, when they go to build high schools, they come look at the Geigel because they say it's held its purpose. And it's still a great place to see a game. Besides Geno's, what other places did do you see in the filming that were like iconic places in Philly that sort of resonated with you?
I was at another local park. It had a beautiful background and a nice mural of like, I think it was Bill Russell. And they just looked for a lot of places that was good with sun and shade. And there's a nice train station. It was a hot off the ground train station. Mm-hmm. It's just a nice background, nice landscape. Mm-hmm. So they cleaned up the park and they made it look nice and we just went on there.
Yeah, I mean, I think for the movie itself, I would consider myself a big movie guy, and I think they showed a lot of love to the city and the surrounding communities to, you know, Philadelphia. Manny Young's in there, big role. For me, my scene was at the Palestra, and as a basketball guy, I've never had an opportunity to go there. I was there as a little kid, but I didn't remember. So to take that and kind of soak that campus in for the day, it was pretty cool. But I knew once I heard Sandler's name involved, it was going to be the real deal. And, he's one of the biggest names in our generation, from whether it's a comedy or a drama or, anything he's involved in. And then you team him up with, one of the greatest basketball players of all time. So I had a lot of faith that it was going to be good, but I think they just, it was perfect for the, for the city of Philly and putting it on the map in ways that, the average person doesn't get to appreciate.
Yeah. So what advice would you give to these young people if they had this opportunity? What would you do different, or if you get another chance, what would you do?
Well, I might have to start an acting career now. I didn't know this was an avenue. No, I'm teasing. No, it was a cool experience. I think now with social media, more and more opportunities will present themselves like this. I've been out of the bat playing basketball like on a serious level for a few years now. I still do men's leagues and things like that. So it was a cool opportunity to kind of get back in the gym and just be around the guys, like the camaraderie, for like one more time on a serious level. But I think just keep your eyes open. You never know who's watching when it comes to whether you're at an AAU tournament, getting recruited, or. And don't ever forget, if my one piece of advice, you never know who somebody else knows. And someone's always watching. Just because, you might not have a good game against somebody or a certain coach at a certain school, that doesn't mean that guy's best friend doesn't coach at another school and he doesn't call him up right afterward and say, this guy's not a good fit for us or girl, but, I think they're going to be a good fit for you. So just... that's my one piece of advice. You never know who's watching or who's in the gym or at the park or, in your local community. And then, take advantage of every opportunity you can get.
Some advice I would give to you guys is just keep working on what you're best at and just take every opportunity and build connections with people you play basketball with. Me, I played in a lot of places all along the East Coast, New York, Philly, here, Reading, Delaware, Virginia. I even played a little bit out in Florida. I played and build connections with everybody I play with, because that person can be a link to somewhere else. That's just, don't look back and keep playing.
My advice to you guys is just to be more interactive with each other. For example, on set, I came across a guy, you guys familiar with Lethal Shooter? Chris Matthews, right? He played in Iceland many, many years ago, and I finished my career in Iceland. So we kind of had that connection, but we had never actually met in person. So when I saw him there, I know I was the same way. I mean, guys, when I was 15, 16, I wasn't really okay with networking. I really kind of stayed to myself. I didn't want to go up and talk to people that I didn't know. We were familiar with each other, but I decided, during lunch, that we would sit down and talk to each other, right? And so I guess because of his relationships and putting himself out there and networking with people, he served as he did the choreography, right?
Yeah.
For the basketball scenes. And, to be honest, he's very talented in his own right and accomplished in his own right. But if you guys are all hoopers yourselves, these avenues are available to you. For him, I was literally sitting on the phone, sitting next to him while he's on the phone. So this agent, that's a $150,000 check. And he was there a week. And his agent was saying, hurry up and get back home because I got a podcast for you to do. He said, I'm going to be tired. He said, no, just make sure you come back. That was a $10,000 check to talk for an hour, right? But, just like he said, you never know who knows who, right? Just being able to talk to people and network with people. It's very important. I just saw the coach leave out. I'm sorry.
Coach Miller.
His name.
Yeah.
Right. We've never met before, but he's familiar with my high school, and I had some kids from the school that I was trying to help plug and maybe possibly get recruited. Maybe he doesn't take any of them, but it's always worth a shot. So it's always best to just kind of make sure you lead with that. Communication is important.
The other major question, and you guys sort of got into it, or you were just talking about pay. And I know that's what some of these students want to know, mm-hmm. how much you got paid or how did you get paid. I don't know if you care to delve into that, but tell them how they paid you or how much you got paid.
Right. All right, so that's this whole thing. Like, everybody likes to talk money, because I don't know about you guys, I like to talk money. So this is how this thing works, right? I know everybody, we all had experiences. Right? See, now I'm waking up right here, right? So this is what I learned about the acting business. The first thing is you have union actors and non-union actors, right? Maybe, right, you guys are familiar with that? So I wasn't familiar with how it worked, but I got a crash course on it, okay? This is what it means when you're non-union, right? You are not part of an acting gang, right? You don't have a crew. You don't have representation. You don't have any of these things. So the way they based, I guess, the pay or the money or the compensation is that if you're non-union, I think it was like $150 for 8 hours, right? That's how they structure it. If you're union, right, if you're crewed up, if you got a gang, if you're a member of somebody, just be a member of somebody. I don't know what the union, the name of it is, right?
SAG.
Right, SAG. There you go, right? It's SAG. That rate went up to $205 per 8 hours, right? So here's how it works. If you work for 8 hours, you get you'll get $205, right? And then for the next 2 hours, so from 8 to 10, let's say, you get what they call time and a half or something like that. Right? So now you're going, you know, I guess time and a half, 150%. If it goes over that, you're going for the next 2 hours after that, so hours 3 through 4, it's double time. And if it goes over that, you get a full pay, just a double pay for a whole day's worth of work, right? So I was fortunate enough, I don't know how, by the grace of God, they mistakenly cast me as a union actor. Right? No. So I was getting the good, I was okay.
You know this is on TV, go
right.
ahead.
Oh yeah, okay, yeah, sorry, well, you know, right? So I got cast as a union guy. You'll know the union people from the non-union people immediately because it's a caste system. When you walk over for lunch, there's a non-union line. You guys get a sub, it's a turkey and cheese sandwich, a bag of chips and water. It's essentially like prison. So you're on prison at the Adam Sandler kind of on set. Me, I was higher up. Yeah, I was higher up. I looked down my nose at the scumbag non-union actors and made my way to the right next to Adam. I said, is it okay if I call you Ad? He said, no. I said, okay, I'm just seeing what's up. We got to eat from a smorgasbord of, I don't know, it was grilled chicken. It was sometimes Geno's. We had juice. They had water. We had juice. I preferred the juice. They had cookies, not the generic ones. They had sometimes generic snacks. We had the grandma's cookies, so it was great. I worked for a whole week. I know. I think you guys, you're.
I was only a day. I was one day.
Right. I sat up there for a whole week. Right on that balcony.
I would have milked every second.
Yeah. Oh, I did. Yeah. I finished the week. I was 14 pounds heavier. It didn't make a difference. Yeah. They were going to cast me for another role. In the biggest kind of, you know, bring your weight down kind of reality show thing. That's what I was going for. So at the end of the week, I came out with a check with $4,800. I said, yeah, right? See, I seen them look, right? You turn, see, yeah, that ain't bad, right? I sat there and I guess maybe what, 99.9% of the day, I sat on the balcony and watched the stars do what they do. For the other 1%, they said, hey, extra, stand up and do your thing. They say, rolling, that's the thing, rolling. I kind of got tired of hearing that. And for that one little second, I got up, I did my hand motion. I said, oh, it's up 42%. I sat back down, I got more chicken fingers, and that was my day. Yeah, so about almost $5,000 for essentially nothing.
Yeah, I was union as well, so my payout was pretty close to his. We're around the same time frame. But that non-union line, we were outside, and it wrapped around the corner. So a lot of people didn't get to see food in a couple hours because how many background people were there. But I had like Six Flags Fast Pass to get my food. So.
Yeah, I will say I was only there for a day. Definitely not a union guy, but I did have a uniform on mm-hmm. from the game. So I think a lot of people thought I was way more important than I actually was. So I was able to cut some lines, which I didn't do. I was like, hey, it's not a big deal. But yeah, we had breakfast, lunch. I think I woke up at 2 a.m. or I actually didn't go to sleep because I was nervous that I wouldn't wake up. And I had to be at Wells Fargo, I think, at 3 a.m. or 4 a.m. And I got home at 8 or 9 o'clock. So, yeah, that overtime money was nice. And then I was fortunate enough to take a PTO day from work. So I kind of double dipped there for the day. But
once again, this is on TV.
Yeah. No, I think I was praying they were going to ask me for another day, but I think I was towards, I think on the call sheet it was, 148 of 150th day. So, it was great.
But the experience.
The experience is worth more of it, but the point of the whole thing is this is an avenue for people to make a living. Mm-hmm. There were some extras, I think, that were there. There was a group of triplets, these three women, and someone was like, this is like their, 100th movie they've been in. Like, they just do as an extra, and they might make way less than, maybe what we made for the day. But, like you say, going back to before with social media and everything, I think this is a lucrative business, and it's a good way to get in and kind of expand, like, my opening to, what this world is like.
Okay. I have some news for you as students, and I shared this with the panelists back in the room. I think it was yesterday, I read something from Netflix where they are in negotiations with LeBron to shoot a Hustle 2. And what we want to happen is we want that they would shoot part of that movie in Reading. And that's why we had you guys take headshots, because we want to hopefully get them, interested in Reading. But as you know, it was LeBron's company that produced this movie. So what we're hoping to do, the Reading kids, and all you guys probably know this, we actually have a connect with LeBron. Does anybody know who it is?
Lonnie.
So what I was told is, but we have to ask LeBron to do Hustle 2 in Reading.
LeBron!